tonight we're going to be talking about the humility of justification. That may sound kind of unusual, and I guarantee you that we're going to be touching things that you probably have not heard before. Romans chapter 5, verse 1 through, we're just going to look at verse 2, two verses. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him we have obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Amplified says this: therefore, since we are justified, acquitted, declared righteous, and given a right standing with God through faith, let us grasp the fact that we have peace, the peace of reconciliation, to hold and to enjoy peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One. And it really does go along with Ephesians 1, doesn't it? Where, remember, in Ephesians 1, he's praying. He's saying, I remember you in my prayers, and I'm praying that, you know, these are people with faith. These are people who've captured something. They saw something. They felt something. They realized something, experienced something of God. And so they're working it out. They're displaying love, and they're letting the love of God that's been shed in their hearts begin to express itself. And Paul says, I've heard of your love. I heard of your testimony. And so every time I think of you, I remember you in prayers. I'm praying that God would give you the spirit of wisdom and understanding, and having the hearts, eyes of your hearts, what? Enlightened. I pray that you see, but I want you to see more. You know, but I want you to know more. And there's always this call up. There's more to see. There's more to know. There's more to experience. And religion would keep us at a plateau and make us believe that we're being spiritual or close to God. And all we're doing is spinning around, and we're dying in the process. The frog in the kettle. It boiled alive without even realizing it. And God is exposing those things. One thing that we're after is, we talked about this, a community that is vulnerable, a community that is real, but a community that is unshockable. And we're going to touch on that in this tonight with justification. You go, what does that have to do with being unshockable? Because when you understand unshockable justification, you're going to understand, I think, in a new way, a new standing of humility that really needs to be a part of our lives. Let's talk about the definition. What, in your mind, what do you think of when you think of justification? Just as if I've never sinned. That's good. Okay, being made clean before the Lord. Somebody used an analogy where they were in another country. They had their Rolls Royce shipped over there, and they're driving it around some third world country, and it had some mechanical problems. And so then they called the dealership, and they had somebody fly from the U.S. and took care of the mechanical problems, fixed it. And then after his trip was over, he went back to the U.S. and he called the dealership and says, you know, he didn't know what the charge is going to be. What's the charge? They said, we have no record of anything going wrong. We don't have any record of it. So we're unable to charge you for it because there's no record of it. So that's another way of thinking of justification, where we've found ourselves guilty. We may not have committed murder, but all of us have sinned and fallen short of God's glory, right? Yeah. And so we all deserve God's justice, and justice that would say, I have to punish sin. And so to punish sin, that's eternal separation. And through Christ paid a debt that he did not owe, right? We owed a debt we could not pay, right? That song? It is the declared purpose of God to regard and treat those sinners who believe in Jesus Christ as if they had not sinned on the ground of the merits of the Savior. Now, if we're treated like we have not sinned, it's really giving us a fresh start, isn't it? But we're going to look at in a moment, what does that fresh start create in our life? All the good that comes out of it, all the righteous acts that come out of it, all the things that would make you a good neighbor coming out of it, because you've been justified. Just for your information, you may want to look at this. I like this chart here. It's the model of a cross-centered life: justification, sanctification. I like their definition of justification. It says, I fix my eyes on Jesus, I repent of self-salvation strategies, and I believe that Jesus is my perfect righteousness, right? And then Jesus worked for me, and then in sanctification, Jesus works in me. And then justification, I have a new legal status before God, fully forgiven and perfectly righteous. And then I have a new living hope to live as God's son or daughter. I possess the root of positional justification. So, Mike, you talked about last week about being seated with Christ in heavenly places. Why are we seated with Christ in heavenly places? It's because of something we obtained or acquired in our own efforts. There's nothing in the world that we could ever purchase, buy, or hope to do, no matter how clean we are and how we could be Mother Teresa times 100 and still never be able to be seated with Christ. The only reason we've given that positional place of authority is because of Christ's blood, because of His sacrifice, because He became a curse for us. He took our sins upon Himself, and He says, I have now bridged the gap between you and God, and I am that bridge, and you can come through me to the Father. That's justification. And when the Father looks at you, the Father sees no wrong. No repair record, no wrong. Isn't that amazing?
It is.
But the challenge is we have a hard time receiving that, don't we? Do we ever miss His justification? Do we ever miss it? What happened to the Galatians? Does anybody know the story of the Galatians? They started well, didn't they?
Yes.
They started with understanding justification by faith. But then Paul says in chapter 3, he says, he calls them what? O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Or who's put a hex or spell on you? It was shocking because they had begun the race with Christ, understanding they could not enter in by themselves with their own works. And somehow, because of some false teaching in the church, they started working, trying to work their way to God's favor again. And that happens to us all the time. Verse 16 of chapter 2, we know that a person is not justified by works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. So we also have believed in Christ Jesus in order to be justified by faith in Christ and not by works of the law, because by works of the law, no one will be justified. We all say yes, and we say amen to that, we agree to that. But what I want to do is we're going to unpack some things tonight and see how subtle this works thing is and how subtle our self-salvation plays a role in our Christian experience more than we realize. And so what we're going to do is we're going to look at a contrast, a picture of Jesus took a picture of two men. And I know that in this story, the justification had not taken place yet. Christ had not come to the cross yet, right? So we need to look at the gospel, especially in the gospels, you always look at it in reverse. If you look at all the Gospels, they're always telling you to look at it in reverse. They begin with, here's why Jesus came, here's why Jesus is dying, here's why Jesus is salvation is for you. So everything you read is with that in mind, with His completed work. Everything you read in the Gospels is to be read as if Jesus had completely finished the process, and He completed the task, and He won favor before God for us. Right? So there's two pictures here, and let's take a look at it. He says, chapter 18, verse 9 through 14 of Luke, says, He also told us this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous. Some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and treated others with contempt. Two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, God, I thank you. Oh, I put my parentheses in there, didn't I? That's my own notes, because what he's doing is that the Pharisee standing by himself prayed, and he's making a statement, this is who I am. God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. Then he goes on to make a statement of what he does. I fast twice a week, I give tithes of all that I get. But the tax collector, staying far off, would not even lift up his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And I tell you, this man went down to his house justified. That's a scary thought, right? Both of them coming to prayer, only one leaving justified. Rather than the other. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. And by the way, the one that went home not justified, he didn't know that he was not justified. That's a scary thing. The one was justified, the one wasn't. I'm going to try to unpack for you in just a moment here, in just these a few minutes here, how we can, if we're not careful, some pride can set in. And because of our position in Christ, because of the good things that God has done in us, a pride can set in and begin to flavor everything we do, but we're not realizing it. And it becomes, we begin to navigate more and more like this picture, away from the tax collector. We find ourselves more like the Pharisee. There are three things in a person who trusts in himself that he is righteous. Can you say that word? Trust in himself that he is righteous. That's what he did. Say it. Trust in himself that he is righteous. Now we're going to camp on that, and I'm going to stretch you for a little bit, because you probably haven't heard something like this tonight. When I've heard the story, it's always been, okay, here's a tax collector, and he was just completely bankrupt spiritually, and he's beating his chest saying, I need God, I need mercy. And here's this proud Pharisee, and every one of us don't like Pharisees, do we? But there are three things we see in this person, the Pharisee, that he trusts in himself that he's righteous. The first one is his righteousness is moral. His righteousness is moral. That goes to who he is, okay? Two men went up into the temple to pray. One a Pharisee, that's the one that trusts in himself that he is righteous. And the other, a tax collector, who had a terrible reputation for cheating the people. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, God, I thank you that I am not like other men, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. So now notice how he presents his righteousness. He presents his righteousness by saying, I am not like others. I'm not an extortioner. I'm not a robber. I'm not a thief. I'm not a cheat. I'm not unjust. I am faithful to my wife. I'm financially honest. I deal with people honestly. I'm not sexually unfaithful to my wife. And that is what I am. I'm a morally righteous. He is a morally upright man. This man is morally upright. Okay? How many wouldn't want somebody like that in your life, in your board, or in your neighborhood, in your business, right?
Yeah.
A morally right person. Secondly, his righteousness is religious. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I get. So there is spiritual disciplines this guy is entering into. He's a disciplined man. And he's saying, I fast twice a week. I give tithes. This is part of being a morally upright and religious devout man. Here's one that you might be a shocker for you. His righteousness, he believed that his righteousness was the gift of God. Verse 11, who's the Pharisee praying to? Who's he thanking?
God.
He's thanking, praying to God, thanking God. And he is saying, I am not like the other men, but he is saying, I am righteous. I am morally right. I'm devout. Thank you, God, for making me righteous. Thank you, God, for making me devout. Thank you, God, for the disciplines in my life that I think are pretty good. Thank you, God, for working righteousness in me and making me faithful to my wife. Thank you, God, for working righteousness in me and I no longer swear. You've cleaned up my language. You've cleaned up my thoughts. You've cleaned up my life. I'm righteous. Thank you, God, for making me righteous. I just want that to sink in for a moment. He gives God credit for making him upright and devout. And he's not even saying that he's done it on his own. And there's a lot of I's in there, but he's not saying he's done it on his own. He's attributing God for his righteousness. Verse 9, Jesus told the parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous. Now make sure you see what he's saying. He's not saying that he is trusting in himself to make himself righteous. He says explicitly he is thanking God for that. He is not trusting in himself to make himself righteous. He is trusting in himself that he is righteous. What is he trusting in? That he's righteous. So he's trusting in the gift and not the giver. Okay? I'm going to lay a foundation and we're going to go really quickly. But he's trusting the gift, not the giver. The gift is righteousness. And God, he says, God, I need you. And God comes, gifts him with justification, righteousness. He does that with us. And then all these things change. Language changes, relationships change, right? All your dealings, you're an honest, integrous, devout person now because of God's righteousness. And then if we're not careful, we can take a look at and start beginning to thank God for the righteousness that we have. And we begin to put more emphasis on the gift than the giver. And that's what he's doing here. So this man was trusting in the wrong thing. He was looking at the wrong basis for his righteousness before God. He was looking at the wrong ground for his righteousness before God. He was looking at the wrong person for his righteousness. He was looking at the wrong righteousness. He was looking at his own righteousness. Now, who gave him that righteousness? God. But it turned where he took that righteousness and turned inward, and he says, this is pretty good. I like this. And so something that was meant for good has turned about to be something that became a point of pride. He was trusting the gift, not the giver. I like what John Piper says, the problem today, what Jesus wants us to see here is that how righteous you are, or how moral you are, or how religious you are, or whether God has produced that in you, or you have produced that in yourself, that is not the basis of your justification before God. That is not how you are accepted and declared righteous in God's law court. Okay? So we get this. This is kind of foundational understanding, because we're going to launch into some comparisons and really see how it hits home, because it's going to deal with our relationships, the way we relate to each other. Okay? But what did the tax collector do? The tax collector did, he looked away from himself to God. He trusted in nothing in himself. He trusted in God. And Jesus said, God declared him righteous in his law court. That's what justified means. Okay? So those who trust themselves and those who trust Christ. He goes in Luke chapter 14 there. We've already read it. I want us to go through a comparison. We're going to write in our notes here and have some fun with this, okay? Two phrases at the very top, verse 9, and then the last phrase in verse 14. Verse 9 says, to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous. He starts with, they trusted in themselves, ends with, everyone who exalts himself, when you trust yourself, you're exalting yourself. So he says, those who trust in themselves, exalt themselves, they're going to be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted. And so you see the picture of the Pharisee and the tax collector in that picture. The one who humbled himself and the one who exalted himself, trusted in themselves. Even though it was good, he still trusted in himself. So what happens when we begin to give trust in the gift of righteousness and not the giver of righteousness? What happens when we trust the gift and not the giver? First thing is, it develops a list of do's and don'ts are formed. I want us to just kind of run through this and test ourselves for a little bit, okay? And ask yourself if some of these things are an issue. A list of do's and don'ts are formed. In fact, that list becomes exaggerated. Remember, he said, I fast how many times a week?
Twice.
Twice. He wasn't even required to fast twice a week. Mm-hmm. They take the list and they add on to it. If I'm supposed to fast once a week, I'm going to fast twice a week. And they start exaggerating. The list of do's and don'ts begin to build up. So we begin to measure ourselves based on how well we perform according to that list, don't we? So humility is not measured by our list of do's and don'ts. Secondly, it produces performance, and we begin to measure ourselves by how well we are improving in Him. I really want us to search our hearts, because if we start trusting His righteousness and stop trusting Him, it can create a performance where we begin to measure ourselves by how well we are improving in Him. What do you mean? His righteousness is coming and improving my life. How many would agree His righteousness improves our lives? But His righteousness improving our lives is not meant for us to put trust in the improvement. But it's always to be dependent on Him. He is our improvement. He is our steady. Not us.
He's our what?
He's our steady. Not us. He's the plumb line. He's the one we always go to.
Yeah.
It produces performance. We begin to measure ourselves by how well we are improving. Here's how subtle this is. Because we can be thanking God the whole time we're doing this. Mm-hmm. You can be at a prayer meeting and giving praise to God. You can be worshiping with heart worship and you say, Thank you, Lord, for what you've done in my life. Thank you, Father, for improving my life. I don't swear. I don't drink. I don't run around. I'm faithful to my wife. You've made me a pretty good person. Thank you, Lord. And you can be thanking him the whole time, putting your trust in the improvement instead of putting your trust in him. And that's the subtlety. The humility is we're not measured by performance. We rely on performance of Christ who became sin for us and rescued us. We're always finding ourselves dependent on him. Humility is we're not measured by performance. We rely on the performance of Christ who became sin for us and rescued us, as 2 Corinthians 5:21 says. The third one is it intrudes into the love affair we are meant to have in Christ. We begin to come under a weight of condemnation and a spirit of mockery that seeks to keep us from being seated with Christ in the heavenly places. And I have there, it seeks to unsettle or unseat us from being seated with Christ in the heavenly places. I'm not worthy to be seated with him. How can I take that place of authority, right? It intrudes upon the love affair. Because we have lists, we have performance, and we're not performing as well as we thought. And some of us have experienced this, where you're a Christian for a while, and you see this massive change, a turnaround. You're no longer robbing and stealing, and you're now a faithful, good citizen, right? And all of a sudden, these things change, and then you go along, and all of a sudden, your improvement, your performance doesn't measure up, and then it begins to affect your love affair with Christ. Here's something to think about here. There's a book called The Principles of Spiritual Growth by Miles J. Stanford, and he talks about the proper attitude of man under grace. Look at this. The proper attitude of man under grace is to believe and be content to be loved while unworthy is the great secret. How many have struggled with that? Just talk to yourself, or yeah. Can we believe and be content that we're loved while unworthy? Do we wrestle with that? To be disappointed with yourself is to have believed in yourself. How many have wrestled with disappointment in yourself? Mm-hmm. To be disappointed with yourself is to have believed in yourself. Okay? To be discouraged is unbelief as to God's purpose and plan of blessing for you. How many have suffered discouragement? Listen, here's the point. If we wrestle with discouragement, if we wrestle with disappointment, we don't understand justification. We haven't grasped justification and grasped the peace of God. Because if we truly understand and have faith, right, that we're justified by faith, we need to exercise more faith, because if we're wrestling with discouragement and disappointments and trying to make ourselves even better, then we're not trusting him. To be discouraged is unbelief. To be proud is to be blind, for we have no standing before God in ourselves. And the lack of divine blessing therefore comes from unbelief and not from failure of devotion. Let me say one more thing, and I want you to help me what humility is. To preach devotion first and blessing second is to reverse God's order. As Miles Stanford says, and preach law, not grace. The law made man's blessing depend on devotion. Grace confers undeserved, unconditional blessing. Our devotion may follow, but does not always do so in proper measure. Is this helpful?
Yeah.
To preach devotion first and blessing second is to reverse God's order. How many have thought, well, if I'm really devoted and if I really pray and I serve the Lord, I read my Bible, I've memorized the Word, then I'm a candidate for His blessing?
Yeah.
We're under law if we do that.
Yeah.
So, what would you say is the mark of humility? Look at this. Here's humility. Humility is to believe and to be content to be loved while unworthy. Like you're talking about, Mike. Mm-hmm. To refuse to make resolutions and vows, for that is trust in the flesh. Mm-hmm. If we're walking in humility, we're going to be much more reserved in resolutions and vows, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe not at all. Here, I love this. To expect to be blessed, though realizing more and more lack of your worth of it. We can create some unholy expectations in our lives that creates separation, missed appointments, scarcity, lack, and so on. But humility is to expect to be blessed even though you're unworthy. It's the ability to stand in his presence when instead of come crawling and groveling in. Come boldly before the throne of grace and receive your mercy and help in time of need. Humility is coming boldly before him. That's humility. Not whimpering and saying, I'm unworthy, I'm a worm, I'm no good, and we're so us focused and me focused, and we're looking in the mirror and seeing all our wrong things in us. And he's saying, I want you to take on my justification because I want you to see yourself through my eyes. I don't see any wrong. You're accepted, right? Humility is expecting to be blessed. Humility is relying on God's chastening hand as a mark of his kindness. It's when we're proud that we're unable to receive the discipline of God and we're unable to move to maturity, right? He wants to free us from fear. Slaves serve out of fear. Sons serve out of love. And he's after sonship and daughters, sons and daughters. And so he will pour out his love. He's wooing us with his love, pouring his affection on us. So trusting in ourselves causes us to live in continual fear. We're waiting for the shoe to drop, right? But in Christ, if we're trusting him, we're able to walk in love because his love casts out fear. It shuts down confession and prevents further workings of grace. What do I mean by that? Because finding out, listen, what is confession? Confession is you're finding out something, right? You're finding out something that's ugly or bad about you, right? You failed, you sinned, you did something wrong. What is confession? That's what it does, right? Why is it that when we trust ourselves, why does it shut confession down? Because if the moment we allow confession to take place, we are scandalizing ourselves. The Holy Spirit wants to reveal deeper things. He peels back the onion. Isaiah chapter 6, here is the prophet Isaiah. He's already serving as a prophet. He's already a mouthpiece of God, right? What does it say there in Scripture? He says he had an encounter with God, a whole new dimension where he says he sees the holiness of God and angels and the throne room of God, and he says, woe is me, I'm a man of unclean lips and I dwell among a people of unclean lips. See, but if we're trusting in ourselves, we're never going to get that kind of encounter, and we won't allow God to pull back the layers. One time I was, in my early years in youth pastoring, I know her name. I could say her name right now. I won't say it, but I'll just say her first name is Lisa. And she was cruel, 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 very, very mean-spirited. And she came in one time in her house and just tore into me. Tish, I think you were there, right? She was merciless. But she had no respect for authority whatsoever, leadership, anybody. And she tore into me. And it was awful. And I really had to work through forgiveness. And I was saying, Lord, I forgive her. I release her of the wrong. And I thought I settled it. Okay, I'm his righteousness in me working forgiveness, right? And so I'm working that out. Well, this next Sunday comes along, and all the young people up there at the altar were praying for people. I went up there. I saw this one young lady praying. I didn't know who it was. I put my hand on her back, started praying for her. Then I kind of moved to the side, and I saw her, and it was Lisa. And I pulled my hand away. I immediately pulled my hand away. And then the Holy Spirit said, I thought you forgave. I thought so too. I thought I did. There was another layer. There was another dimension or room or little crevice of offense that I just wasn't allowing to let go. How many know that God, when he can work deliverance in an area, and that doesn't mean it's all done, right? That can just be the beginning. He has to do layers, and there's sanctification. There's further works of grace. If we shut down confession and we shut down workings of grace, it prevents us from praying, search me, O God, as Psalm 139 says, Search me, O God, see if there be any wicked way in me. Psalm 139, verse 1 says, you see me, you know everything about me. He ends the chapter by saying, see me more. Search more. Let me know more what you see in me. See if there's anything wicked in me, anything that would separate me from you or displease you. 1 John talks about us walking in confession, walking in the light, confessing our faults to one another, and the blood of Jesus will cleanse us from all of our sins, right? My question I ask is this, is if we're walking in humility, the question is, how much are we practicing confession with each other? A sign of humility is a sign of openness about our own failings and brokenness and our faults and misgivings and our sins. Right? John Wesley and confession. It says in his meetings, John Wesley would ask four questions. And he was a holiness preacher, right? But in his meetings, they'd ask these four things. How would you like to sit under this for every week? What known sins have you committed since our last meeting? Right? I think we'd clear out churches, right, with these four questions.
Bless you, Father, for I have sinned.
What temptations have you met with? How were you delivered? And what have you thought, said, or done of which you doubt whether it be sin or not? How many know Christians today that are practicing this? How many of us are practicing this? I think it's a good practice to get into confession. Let me just close with one more thing, okay? Let me just skip this number 7, okay? I'm going to close with this. 6 is a freebie. Creates a posturing, because I want to tie that in with confession this week, okay? Creates a posturing or even a self-imposed blindness with ourselves and others. So humility is the ability to be real with ourselves and others and God. And I'll tell you this, Mike knows this, and Kristen knows this, everybody knows this. I often ask the scale of 1 to 10, where are you in whatever it is? I'll ask the question like, okay, on a fear level, where are you on a scale of 1 to 10? Or are you, what's the, tell me something that you wrestle with. For example, I may happen sometime in the future, Eric. We'll sit down over coffee and I'll say, I'm warning you right now. Tell me, because to me this is the level of openness that we experience when I see this happening. And I'm waiting for a voluntary answer. Tell me where you wrestle the most in your life. On a scale of 1 to 10, where are you in that wrestle? 10 being you're just totally off, you're failing at this thing, or maybe the opposite. 1 is you're failing, 10 is you're succeeding everything. And if you give me the middle of the road answer, then I'm always walk away saying, we're not there yet.
If you give a 5,
we're not there yet. Now, there are things in our lives that we're at 5s with, right, Mike? There are things at 4 and 5s. We're at 4 and 5s. I have 4 and 5s in my life, or 6s, that kind of thing. What I'm listening for is the 1s and the 2s and the 9s and the 10s. I'm listening for those things. Because that tells me the level of humility that's working in a person. Now that informs me the level of humility that's working in me is my ability to be a 10 or 1. 2 weeks ago, I called Pastor Don up. I won't tell you our conversation, but I called him up and I said, on a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being drastic, this is out of control, I said, I'm at a 10 plus, man. I needed to be that real with him. Okay? So wherever you scale it, I think a scale really works. And Dennis Peacock talks about that. A scale is being able to say, okay, where are you at in this situation? When we're looking at this word, or we're looking at scripture, and it's provoking something in us, where are we at? On a scale of 1 to 10, 10 being totally faithful to that, 1 failing miserably. Where are you at? And listen to yourself talk. Listen to your spouse talk. And that tells you the level of humility that's working in us. And the challenge is this, if we're going to embrace justification, then let us embrace confession. And let us embrace not a posturing or being, because that posturing or that hiding, it creates a self-imposed blindness. We don't come into reality ourselves, and then people that we talk to aren't in reality about where we're at. We need each other, and we need to tell each other what we're really going through. It really concerns me sometimes if If all I'm hearing is praise, 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 I'm saying the New Testament church wasn't built on praise. John Wesley didn't build his organization on praise. God doesn't build on praise like that. He builds on confession.
A lot of people get really uncomfortable when you say what's going on.
That's the other side. I was going to say, you know, I'm going to be careful about what level I say I'm really at, because it depends on the other person's ability to hear at that level. And sometimes a relationship, how much trust has been established in a relationship, and how invested are they in you? In that relationship.
How trustworthy are they? Are they somebody that's going to go, oh, I'm a Pharisee, and now I have something to criticize you about?
I think the safest place to start practicing this confession is with your prayer time. Mm-hmm. Because we don't talk this way honestly before the Lord. And that's the key. We as Americans or Christians don't. But the word confess in Greek, the word translated confession here, I do a lot of this Hebrew Greek stuff, I'm sorry. It's just Israeli. But it's homologeo. And homo means same, and logeo means to speak. So it's actually to say the same thing as. So when you're confessing, you're not telling anybody new information. And when you're confessing something before the Lord,
he already knows.
You're saying the same thing as, like Ron's saying, being in reality. You're saying the same thing as what he already knows. You're not going to catch him off guard or surprise him.
Oh,
he's
I didn't see that coming.
He's not going to flip out where you're at in your kid. but how many times? It's like when I roll up on William and he's making mischief. And he's in there messing with something. I'm like, what are you doing, Bear? He's not going to surprise me and say, I'm sticking my finger in the light socket. And he'll look at me and go, I'm sticking my finger in the light socket, Dad. Okay, well, you're not supposed to do that, are you, Bear? What did I say? No. Okay, well, now you have trouble. I'll probably go get his time out of trouble. But it's like that with the Lord, and we tell ourselves in meetings like this, oh yeah, it's only like that with the Lord, until we go to pray. And then we're like, oh, what are you doing here? And you know, then we have that what are you doing here moment, because we don't live in that confession all the time. We don't find ourselves in that place of honesty. So, you know, that's a good place to start practicing. And then you start feeling safe.
Well, let me challenge one thing, Mike. Let's start with God and others, because the Bible starts with God and others.
Yeah.
Well, first John says, confess, it says it clearly, confess your faults to what? One another. You need to be about finding that other. And you don't, Marie, go blast all your worst secrets to somebody brand new. You start with your husband and shock him for a little bit, you know? What? I never knew that. But we start with our spouses, right?
Or say the same thing as what he already knows.
He's Italian, I'm Irish.
You know what I'm saying? But it's going to produce a humility, a unity, and a marriage. Confession will produce humility and unity in a relationship like no other. Start pinging people. Send a signal, say something, test the relationship, and see if you can start trusting that relationship. Let's venture out and start trusting more. First off, like you're saying, Mike, absolutely with God, we need to change our conversation with Him and make it more real and open.